That'd be step one. Hey everybody, how are you? Good evening. It's Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. Happy to be here. We had a crazy week this week with T3 going on. We were here last Monday, weren't we? Yeah, we were here last Monday.
Sunday last week we were.
Was it Monday or Tuesday, Wednesday? I think I'm pretty sure we did it. But I want you to let everybody know that I really appreciate everybody joining in today. It's our Q&A. Just wait until a piece of software just logs in like we do every single week here. Hey, Florida, what's going on? Can't wait to get down to Florida. I'll be in Florida in January. Looking forward to it. Looking forward to it tremendously. So what we're going to do is this. If you've never seen my... Your computer's working super slow tonight. Wow. We might have an issue here. Make sure you're on the right internet. Yeah, you seem to be. What's going to happen is, if you've never seen my show before, it's a Q&A show. And what you do is you ask questions, and I will give you immediate answers for all of your dog training questions. I'm a dog trainer, business owner based up in Providence, Rhode Island. We've got a dog training facility. We specialize in aggression rehab and behavior modification. That means we can fix all of your dog training problems. I think I'd probably be in that section right there. We also deal with young little puppies. Hey, Cincinnati, how are you, young little puppies? Off leash and on leash obedience. And we're multifaceted as far as the tools we use. You're gonna hear me talk about punishment a lot. Punishment is not abuse. That conversation should be squashed. We reward for dogs for what we want them to do, and we punish dogs for what we don't want them to do. That's just the way dog training really, really works. You'll notice on this show that I talk about punishment a lot. The reason is because most people ask me, how do I stop? How do I stop a behavior? And the only way to stop a behavior is through punishments. So if you're out there searching for answers, if you're going to a dog trainer now and you can't stop a dog from doing something, you would want to ask the trainer, what's the proper punishment for this unwanted behavior? And if they can't give you an answer, you probably want to look for the dog trainer. And this is not targeted towards any specific dog trainer. It's just you're an owner or a trainer and you want to learn more. So here we go. We can get caught up.
Dog mouths lead. Can't get it out to correct on lead. Bonker just excites him. Chain lead?
No. Dog mouse lead. If your dog is biting the lead and you're using a bonker, it's possible that you're using it wrong. A lot of people do use it wrong. So what you're going to do is the dog. It's very common for dogs to bite the leash. The reason is because that's their way of saying no. You're leading the dog with a leash. So what you do is a bonker. If you don't know what a bonker is, it is a wrapped up towel secured with elastics. What I want you to do is I want you to say the word no, count to one or two, and then I want you to extremely firmly throw the bonker at the dog's head area. Yes, I'm telling you to throw something at your dog's head. What I'm doing, though, is I'm telling you to actually throw a cotton towel at the dog's head. It won't hurt your dog. It won't make your dog hand shy. All those things that you hear about punishment are actually wrong. So if you do it firm enough, hit the dog. Yes, I'm saying throw a towel at the dog's head. That's crap. Now is probably a good time to get off the show. All right? So anytime you want to stop an unwanted behavior, you would throw a bonker, which is a cotton towel. All right? So I'm not saying to hit the dog. Great, dog abusers. Well, I'll get you off before you.
Bye, Felicia.
Right. Okay, so that's what you're going to do. Next.
Hi, guys. Did Sean leave any donuts?
Yes, he did.
Very few.
Half eaten. Next.
Mm-hmm. How much cold can a German Shepherd take? How about puppies? Is it okay to leave them outside in winter?
I would not leave any puppy, usually of any breed, outside in winter. There's way too many variables. German Shepherds also, you have got to define cold. So are you at 0 Celsius? Are you at freezing points? Are you below? All depends. Is there access to any, warm things? So I actually own an outside dog, but it actually has access to a dog house, which is actually climate controlled. I owned an Akita, though, that also had the same setup. It actually was outside in the snow in the middle of the winter and didn't go into its doghouse. So personally, what I would do is always give a dog access to shelter and warmer weather. Next. Not a puppy. Next.
How do I get my dog to stop eating other dogs' duty?
Here we go. So, question, how do you get a dog to stop, through punishment? This would have been a great question for our buddy John over there that I had to ban, how he would do it. And the only way to do it is through punishment. Remote collar on the dog. And what you're going to do is put it at the highest setting, and you'll be inside. Make sure the remote collar fits. We recommend ecollar technologies, and we recommend Dogtra. We don't recommend anything, any of those cheap collars for like $75 and below. So what I want you to do is have it on the dog, make sure it's properly fitted on the dog. You're inside, have the collar on the highest setting, on the continuous button, the dog starts eating the poop, and you activate the remote for 3 seconds. It is extremely uncomfortable, it is extremely painful. You are trying to save the dog's life. A dog could die from eating dog poop, horse poop, rabbit poop. So you want to make it intolerable in order for the dog to stop. You very easily could walk up to the dog and say, you know, leave it, and the dog will leave it. But unfortunately, you will not be able to get the dog to permanently stop that behavior. Next.
Dog extremely anxious, always whining, and has been possessive over random objects. Attacked my other dog.
Okay, so both of that, again, punishment. Okay, where this is where if you've never seen the show before, you're gonna get straight answers. Another cool thing about this, if you ask your average trainer this and they can't give an immediate answer, why would you go to them? So we could fix this very easily. So what I want you to do is anxiety is great for, I've got a video on my YouTube channel on how to fix separation anxiety. As far as resource guarding, again, you're going to use a remote collar and you're going to teach the dog the out command. Teach the dog the out command. Don't forget, I do free Skypes every day for 15-minute free Skypes. You go to my Facebook page and there's a tab that says free Skypes. Next.
Do I stim every time I mark with a no through e-collar? Get great response with a verbal.
Okay. Your no, though, all right, your no is what's really important. Is all depends on what level your dog is at. If it's at the punishment level, therefore it's a known command and the dog is not doing it, you can give your dog a low level if you're doing it's a lower level if you're still training. But if you're at the punishment level, it has to be at a higher level in order for it to have meaning. Next.
How to potty train a dog?
I'm not the potty training guy. There's many, many, many people out there that do a much better job potty training than I do. I would get a YouTube video. What I will tell you to do is you first crate train the dog. So the dog should be in a crate at night and unattended. You want to have a schedule. So schedule its food, schedule its water, and then what I want you to do is I want you to have a leash on the dog to get out to the same door, to the same place. When it goes to the bathroom, you can actually click and reward. Make sure it finishes, though. Next.
Would you ever train a dog while it's on anti-anxiety drugs?
Just for clarification, we have all dogs come off of drugs to come into our training center. You can, but I believe more in training than I do drugs. I absolutely don't deny that drugs can help, but over 90% of the dogs that we work with end up coming off of drugs after a really good training protocol. So I think drugs don't eliminate a lot of things. Next.
I know slip leads with young puppies and lots of positive work. What age starting prong collar and e-collar work?
You can start e-collar work at 14 weeks old, and you're doing it on the marker concept, just like you're doing any verbal marker. And we use food for all of our training of all of our dogs, and we start with a puppy. Prong collar, depending on the weight of the dog, usually 12 or 14 weeks old as well. Next.
My dog runs to fence barking when someone walks by. Otherwise, he's good and obedient.
Okay, again, how do I stop my dog from running the fence line and barking aggressively at human beings? Punishment. Again, remote collar on the dog. And, you know, there's so many ways to do it. What you don't do is this. This is what you don't do. You don't use obedience to fix a behavior problem. Let's remember this. Don't use obedience to fix a behavior problem. So what you don't do is this. Dog runs towards the fence and it's barking. And you recall the dog. Here or come. Dog comes to you. You did not fix the problem. What you're doing is you're just training the dog to recall. That's if the dog even listens to you. because when they're in drive barking, they might not. But even if they do listen to you the first time, you still have not eliminated the act of fence fighting. Don't use obedience to fix a behavior problem. So, remote collar on, you make the act of fence fighting suck. You make the act intolerable, uncomfortable, painful. It works. Next.
My dog is afraid of being touched by strangers and tries to bite. How can I socialize him?
Okay, number one, don't let another human being touch your dog for at least 6 months. Stop doing that. You know you've got a biting dog. It's unethical for letting a human touch your dog. So immediately, as of tonight, don't let anybody touch your dog. Say, nope, you can't touch my dog. First of all, nobody ever needs to touch your dog. Your dog can be social without being petted. I've got very social dogs. They don't get petted. They don't get petted, all right? So what you're gonna do is, right now, I want your dog to exist around human beings. So if you saw my Periscope this afternoon where I was playing Chuck It, and two gentlemen from Amtrak stopped by, they couldn't even pet my dogs. My dogs didn't care about them, right? They didn't care about them. Why? I've trained my dogs not to care about people, but they sure as heck aren't allowed to bite them either. They can't jump on them, they can't bite them, but they really don't care about them. So, right, and then what you're going to do is get your dog to exist around them. That's the first step. We can go on further from there. Next.
Tried Bonker, but even Hard thought it was a game. Corrector spray excited too.
So you probably bonked wrong. Bark firmer or use a remote collar. Next.
Do we ask over Twitter?
No, you ask right here. Just write your question. Write that question. Next.
Dog is dog reactive. Ecollar made it worse. Bonker made it better. Did I mess up Chase with ecollar?
You didn't mess up because you figured it out. Your dog found the bonker more valuable. The issue is a remote collar in the long run is going to work much better for leash reactivity. It's much better for leash reactivity. All right? So you might have been chasing the dog, meaning chasing mean you might have overwhelmed. We find most people that use remote collars, they underwhelm their dog. So what happens is the dog starts getting reactive, they go too low, they send the dog up instead of squashing it. The bonker squashed the behavior, where the remote collar chased the behavior. You'll probably get it too low, but you didn't mess up your dog, you'll be fine. Next.
Gets really hot here in summer. Crating is making them even hotter. Tried a cooling mat, but that does not help.
Okay. Well, crating will save the dog's life because of they can destroy something in the house. They can ingest it. They can pee. They can poo. They can break out of your home. I would suggest air conditioning, and I would also suggest a fan. Mm. You know, next.
Witness a 6 to 7 year old frustrated kid wailing on a teenage-ish puppy tonight.
I would probably hope there'd be an adult around, and if I saw a child that age, which doesn't understand the concept of punishment, he was probably frustrated, I most likely would have intervened. I usually stay in my lane. I stay in my lane. I mind my own business. I would have probably walked over to the child and just asked them if something was wrong and if you could help. But normally, I stay out of everybody's business. I'm not an ambulance-chasing dog trainer. If you're struggling with your dog, I'll just watch you go by. But if a dog is in danger or if a human is in danger, I will do something. I will do something. Next.
Why is my German Shepherd great but high maintenance?
You know, the question is, why is your dog great and high maintenance? Most dogs can be very challenging. German Shepherds, if you have a high drive dog of a lot of different breeds, you're going to have to work your butt off a little bit more. Dog ownership in general takes a lot of time. Next.
Do you put anything on their paws in the winter?
I personally do not, but there's many products on the market and I'm not knowledgeable about that. Next.
Recommend any German Shepherd trainers in North New Jersey.
Okay, you don't need to find a German Shepherd trainer. You need to find a good dog trainer. Any good dog trainer can work with any breed there is. Breed never matters to us. Breed never matters to us. We focus on the behavior, training the good and eliminating the bad. So in northern New Jersey, I don't know any off the top of my head, but I'm sure there is many, many. So if you want to do a boarding train, we're close enough. If you're looking for one-on-ones, there's got to be some people in New York City. There's got to be some, there has to be. I would just Google it. Google Balance Trainer. Go to their website. Snoop around their videos. Watch their social media. See, look for some before and after stuff and see the kind of work they do. Next.
All right. Someone asked where I'm reading the questions from.
We already answered that. Next.
We're stuck for a second. Hold on, guys.
So, Mr. Bossman, great things are not stupid dogs. Let's keep it. Let's not write that. I don't have to ban you. Just a little bit of a warning there.
All right. Well, something happened. Right. 11. No, that's not right.
Jeff Gellman, solid.
Read something from up there.
There's nothing there, honey. Please give me a question. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. You can go to rvdogtrainer.com. rvdogtrainer.com.
Leash reactivity using e-collar correct when posturing. I have to use it on high level for every walk.
So for every walk, you shouldn't have to. So what you're doing is, again, is your high level might not be the high level for the dog. All right? Your high level might not be the high level for the dog. What you need to do, so you're nagging the dog is what you're doing. So you're nagging the dog. You haven't eliminated the problem. Most people are underwhelming their dogs. So what you can do is this. We demonstrated this week at T3, this weekend in Chicago, and all my seminars I demonstrated as well. If you've got a dog that's reactive on every walk, what I want you to do, masterful moms, I love you. You can't put names out on my social media, all right? We can't do that. Because I don't know, there's no context here. There's no context here. We can't do that. All right, thanks. I'm not mad at you. I love you. So, what you're going to do is, at the very beginning of the walk, I want you to make sure your dog understands the proper heel. And as soon as your dog starts challenging that heel, I want you to give that dog a high-level correction. So people struggle with that. People struggle with that. They're like, oh my gosh, you're punishing the dog for barely doing anything. No, you're not. The dog is always giving you a hard time. Start off from the beginning. We're not going to do that today. Watch how the walk gets better. Next.
11-week-old GSD eats his poop. I try to immediately pick it up, but he dives for it. Too young for e-collar.
I would bonk the dog for doing that. Next.
Puppy picks up everything in his mouth, his leash, trash, bark, grass. Correct for all each time?
You're going to do one good. What you're going to do is you're going to teach the dog what no means. So whenever you bonk. Oh, thanks, Nikki, for the super heart. Love you. What you're going to do is this. You're going to say no, and you're going to bonk. Again, a bonker is a cotton towel. This whole big thing about dog abuse, you're hitting your dog. Like, the number one age that dogs are surrendered in shelters is pre-1 year old. The reason why dogs are turned into shelters is for this, and mostly this reason only. A lot of people make up a lot of stories. They're moving, there's allergies, blah, 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 blah. I'm not going to discount some of that stuff. But the number one reason that dogs are turned into shelters is because the owners could not stop an unwanted behavior. All right? The owners could not stop an unwanted behavior. If you remember, we just had a dog in, a German Shepherd dog into our board and train. It knew 50 commands. 50 commands it knew. Guess what it didn't know? Not to bite people. 50 commands. The one thing it didn't know was to not bite people. Guess what it learned in our boarding train? Not to bite people. Great. Next.
My puppy is really good in the crate, but whines when we gate him in a room without us. Suggestions?
So you're going to use remote collars. Again, it's remote collars. Again, this is going to be like every one of these is about punishment. It's so funny because we have two shadows in our training center this week. 90% of the day, 95% of the day is all about rewards. You know what I mean? So reward, 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 reward. Guess what though? That 10% of punishment, that's the game changer. That's the game changer. So what was the question?
Whines when it's gated.
So whines is, first of all, don't gate it in a room. Either have it with you in place or down, or have it in the crate and use a remote collar or a bonker to stop whining. Remember, the question is, how do I stop whining? In order to stop an unwanted behavior, there has to be punishment. Next.
Okay. Your advice on stopping fence aggression is spot on.
Thank you very much. We've done it lots of times, and my clients on social media have done it thousands of times. Yep. Next.
How do I fix my dog's obsession with squirrels?
Well, it's not about fixing. It's about the question should be, how do I stop my dog from fixating on squirrels and then chasing squirrels? What you do is you have to punish for that. Again, how do you stop? You punish. What does that look like? Dog's walking, dog's walking, dog's walking. All of a sudden, the dog goes like that. As soon as that, the dog does that, all right? And then you would use the remote collar to tell that dog to stop fixating on squirrels. Okay? All the advice I give, we've done thousands of times. I only give out advice that works for us in all breeds of dogs with all behaviors. So that's why I'm so passionate, and that's why I'm so immediate with my answers. Next.
There's a pic of a dog's neck hurt with prongs from the prong collar on the internet.
Okay, there's two of those pictures, and that's from leaving a dog on a tie-out. So the dog was abused. If it would have had a flat buckle collar on, it would still have a thing. I've seen those two pictures, and guess what? There's probably about 20 million dogs wearing prong collars every day. There's two pictures. There's a lot of pictures out there on harness abuse, flat collar abuse, choke chain abuse, martingale abuse. You know, who cares? Trust me, prong collars don't hurt dogs. We've trained over 4,000 dogs, and we've never seen a dog hurt. So, great.
Yes, and she also said, how in the world can you hurt a dog so badly with this tool?
Right, you can't. It was left on the dog, and it was left on the dog from an early age, and the dog grew into it, or it was left on a tie-out. Next.
Would you fish with the e-collar for whining? It's a constant whining,
yes.
Yowling.
Yes. Yep. So what you do is you go high to stop any movement, and then you fish. Fishing is going up and down on the collar, combination of momentary and continuous, watching the dog, figuring out what levels to go at. Next.
St. Bernard walking all good, then in a second lunges without notice.
So dogs always give a tell. They always give a tell. They use it with their body position. They use it with their ears. They use it with their eyes. They use it with their breathing. So what you've got to do is keep that dog next to you in a proper heel and start understanding what the dog is doing. Remote collar, train that dog to heel properly, and you'll be prepared. Next.
At what age do you start using a bonker?
You can punish a dog at 8 weeks old. Nature does. Nature punishes dogs. So can you. Next. But we don't punish for, like, obedience. So we punish for things such as, like someone said, if I had an eight-week-old puppy that was eating poop, I'd have to punish it. Eight-week-old puppy that's picking things up it's not supposed to, shoes, socks, underwear, Kleenex, children's toys. It has to be, or else you'll never stop it. Next.
What do you think about the black plastic kind of prong-type training collars for a toy breed?
I'm not a big fan of those. I've only used them a couple of times, so I can't give you an expert opinion on them. What I would do is just, for a toy breed, use a 1.75 millimeter prong collar instead. Next.
Why are Great Danes so much harder to train than German Shepherds?
They're not. They're not harder to breed. It's a larger dog. They've got different mobility issues. So what you can do is just follow our training protocols, and you should do okay. Next.
How do you punish for marking? At what point in the marking, or do you punish for sniffing on a walk?
Well, you don't punish for sniffing on a walk. Teach the dog how to properly heel. So if the dog is sniffing, yes, you would give a leash pop to the dog or a remote pop to the dog. But we don't allow sniffing or marking on walks. So that's the answer to that question. Next.
Do you ever bonk for aggression or just for jumping, pulling, bratty behavior?
We also bonk for aggression, but a remote collar is going to work better for you. We will use a bonker as a punisher for any bad behavior. Next.
I disagree. Great Danes are stupid dogs and very hard to
train. I already
told
that person to not say those things.
Okay. Do you know any good balance? Yeah. Oh, here we go. Balance trainers around South Side of Chicago.
I will be. All I can tell you is this: is if you go to rvdogtrainer.com, rvdogtrainer.com, I will be at Canine Tail Shakers next this coming weekend, and there's a wonderful trainer there named Megan. You can ask for her. But if you want to go to that seminar, you can go to that seminar. You'll have a fantastic time. It's 2 days. Your life will change. Next.
My beagle still won't stop scratching my doors when she wants in. House dog. Shock collar doesn't work.
Okay. You didn't use the shock collar properly then. Okay. All I know is this. If I had a remote collar on my dog that I use, which is an ecollar technology collar, and if it was fitted properly, and one of my dogs was scratching on the door, and if I gave that dog a high level correction, I assure you it would work. So it's possible that you're using a inferior remote collar. It was improper. It doesn't make you a bad person, obviously. I'm not yelling at you. It was fitted wrong. The level was too low, and it wasn't used properly. So, but it does work. It works for us every single time. Next.
My Saint will lunge without notice at Wheelie Dog.
We did not. Saint Bernard, yeah.
Not this question.
Okay. Sorry.
Will lunge without notice at mainly dogs, but not all dogs. Very clear.
So what you need to do is read your dog better, understand your dog, teach your dog how to properly walk, remote collar heel that dog, and right now put your dog into avoidance of other dogs, meaning it's not allowed to look at other dogs. The dog always has to look straight ahead or up at you. It doesn't have to do a focused heel. We don't teach focused heels. Straight ahead or up at you. What's going to happen is your dog is going to start, and also going to have to start utilizing space. So your dog is going to start, once you start punishing your dog for lunging at other dogs, it's going to ask you to move away from the other dog. So respect that. Next.
When my dog barks at people on walks, should I correct with prong collar?
Unless you want your dog to continue barking at people on walks, you have to punish it. So yes.
Tips for a collar remote-wise pup.
Wake up in the morning, put the collar on, switch it every 4 to 6 hours. At night, take the collar off. There you go. Thanks, Masterful Moms, for the super heart. Next. We got a lot of questions, guys. We're going to get through them the best we can.
Oh, good evening, Yankee woman. Thank you. I don't know what that's in reference to. Started my puppy on a 2.5 prong. He's now 10 months and 86 pounds. Should I go up to 3?
You can either go up to 3 or add more links. You're going to have to add more links to the 2.5. That would be up to you. Next.
For the bonker, so I'm sure, I bonk on their butt area, right? Mm-hmm. Also correct for puppy chasing tail.
Aim for the head. You do not need an e-collar to come to a seminar. Next.
She has a perfect heel until we encounter another barking dog. I'll try upping the level on e-collar.
Exactly. Also utilize space. I do.
Much higher to prevent nagging.
Right. If I've got a dog, if I see a barking dog, I'm moving my dogs away. I'm not interested in my dogs walking by barking dogs. If I see someone yelling and screaming, I'm walking away from them as well. Same thing. Next.
Where is your and Linda's next vacation going to be?
Where is our first vacation going to be? I don't know.
We went on vacation once.
We went on one vacation. I don't know. I'm trying to get her to get her passport. We have the opportunity to travel the world. Talk to her.
Or don't talk to me about it.
Read the questions.
Will an e-collar fix nervousness around new dogs on leash?
The e-collar helps dramatically with nervousness if you know how to use it in that context. Yes, it will. Next.
A trainer once recommended a light chain as a bonker to the butt for fence fighting. Too harsh?
No, it's not. It's called a throw chain. Throw chains have been around for forever. You can also use a paintball gun as well. But we don't use those. You might as well bonk or use a remote collar. Next.
Will you ever be in Toronto?
Yes, I will. I'll be outside of Toronto. If you go to rvdogtrainer.com, you can see my schedule. Next.
Schnauzer was just attacked by a pit bull that came up from behind. How do you break up a fight?
If there's no other there, you do.
Kicking the pit had no effect.
Kicking. You're going to take a 2x4 to a pity's head. Let's first clarification here. 50% of my business is pitties. They are not the most aggressive breeds whatsoever, but when they do bite, it's horrific. So I'm not going to be like, oh, pits are the best dogs. Pits are great dogs, but when they bite, it's horrific. The best way is you have to choke the dog out. You've got to choke the dog out. So if you don't, if the dog doesn't have a collar on, what you need to do is you need to unleash your, you have got to unclip your leash. If you have a belt on, undo your belt. You have to wrap it around the other dog's neck, and you've got to either do it tourniquet style or hoist that dog up. And then you also have to start kicking at the underbelly, kicking at the underbelly. And depends how, you know, bottom line is, whatever it takes. Take your thumbs, stick it in the dog's eyes, whatever it takes. If my dog was being attacked by another dog, I would do everything it took to get that dog off, especially if it was a power breed. Now, if a Chihuahua was going after one of my German Shepherds, I'm not going to be as extreme. I'll get it, pick it up by the scruff of its neck and just move it to the side. But, you know what I mean? Next.
Will group socialization classes solve nervousness on walks?
All depends on the skill set of the people that are working the socialization. It can make it worse or it can make it better. All trainers are not the same, even if they use the same tools. I have seen fantastic clicker trainers, and I have seen horrific clicker trainers. I have seen fantastic balance trainers, and I've seen horrific balance trainers. Tools don't make the trainer. Next.
Do you think it's okay for dogs to give cats a hard stare from within yard? Doesn't escalate anymore.
If it doesn't escalate anymore, that's fine, but I would probably get that dog to stop staring. Next.
That's the key, that darn hard stare. Gotta stay on it.
Yep.
Anxious dog is walking on leash and then off leash, overexcited. Dog approaches. What do you do? Okay, so dog's on a leash, an unleashed dog comes.
Oh, okay, an unleashed dog comes over, I neutralize the threat. No dog is allowed to meet my dogs on leash. It is the worst thing, okay? It is the worst thing. So what I would do is neutralize that threat. It could be everything from just putting your dog behind you, getting in front of your dog and shouting. You can pick something off the ground and throw it at the dog. There's a lot of different variables you can do. But if the dog gets in your space, then you start using your feet. Next.
My pup wants to play with my two cats. They run away and pup chases. Do I still bonk for wanting to play?
You know, chances are that with the cats, first of all, it's a pup. So does that mean a puppy? It could get worse, even though your dog probably has some, you know, some nice intentions. Do you know what I mean? What I would do is I probably would stop the dog from doing that behavior now. Next.
How do I get a dog to heel off leash? How to have dog come every time?
So both of those are going to be, there's many different ways, but I would recommend a remote collar. So come every time would be to teach recall. So recall is the come command, and there's many ways to do it. We've got videos on that. Teaching the dog for an off-leash heel, you want to do an on-leash heel first. We do remote collar heel, and then you're going to just transfer that to the dog dragging the leash in your pocket, and then removing the leash. So it takes work. It takes a lot of work to do it, but, you know, remote collar is definitely going to expedite the learning curve for you and the dog. Next.
How do you teach a young dog to play properly and evenly with other dogs?
All depends, again, on the other dogs, but if you've got some balanced dogs, then you've got a new dog into the pack. We do dog socialization. What you would do is, you would get that dog to learn how to be not aroused so much. So arousal can be the enemy for a lot of dogs. So what I would do is we use dressage whips. If you saw some photos from this weekend seminar, or no, I think Sean O'Shea, my buddy, did Instagram stories on that. And you can use, oh, thanks, Debbie54, for that super heart. Really appreciate it. You can use a dressage whip to de-escalate the arousal on the dog. It teaches the dog how to be calm. Next.
When you pop with prong collar, do you give the heel command or no command?
Depending on what you want the dog to do. If you want it to heel, you can say heel. But if you're trying to get it to stop an unwanted behavior, you can say no. Next.
Do you correct for excitability in the crate, whining, scratching door?
Absolutely. If we don't correct, remember, the lack of no is yes. The lack of no is yes. Your dog is in a bad state of mind, being excited in the crate, scratching, biting, OCD-type behaviors, biting at the crate. Absolutely. Next.
can or how do I teach my dog to ignore off-lead dogs that run up to us, breaks command to sniff, she ignores, I think it will be saying.
You're asking about...
Oh, she ignores e-collar and commands to sniff them.
So what's going to... Command to sniff... Okay, I get it. Okay, so your remote power is too low. Your remote power is too low. But also, having an off-leash dog run at your dog, I would stop the dog before it got to my dog. But that's one thing. The second thing is the reason why your dog is not listening to you, because you're underwhelming your dog. You're underwhelming your dog. So I'm walking down the street, all right, with a friend of mine, and a woman, a naked woman, comes running up to me, and she starts making out with me. And all of a sudden, my friend keeps walking and goes, "Hey, Jeff, come on, let's get going. Hey, Jeff, come on, let's get going." Who am I paying attention to? Next.
I don't like that. Is it justified to shoot the loose dog that comes up to your dog?
You'd have there would be probably some legalities there. I guess if you thought your life was in danger, your dog's life was in danger, that would be a hard one. If my dog was being attacked by another dog, I would find that justifiable. If my children, me, Linda, someone in the general public, I would find it justifiable. But again, all depends on the breed. If it's a Chihuahua, if it's a little rat terrier, I'm not going to be as concerned. I'm going to look at intent. Can I break up the dog fight with just a good kick? You know what I mean? There's a lot of different variables. Next.
I had to choke a pit and a cane corso to let go of each other after they got into a dominance fight.
Yep, there you go. Yep. And some people might struggle, guys, and out of full respect for everybody, some people might be uncomfortable with some of the conversations about, like, choking a dog out, and now we're just talking about shooting a dog. But the thing is this, if you've never seen a dog attacked by an off-leash dog, and the off-leash dog try to kill that dog, it is a horrific, horrific experience. If you've never seen a true dog fight, we're talking about a dog killed. We're talking about a dog sent to the hospital. If you've never seen a pack attack before, three or four dogs going after one dog, it is a horrific, horrific experience. It's something I would want nobody to ever witness. And if you have the ability to prevent it, I'm going to do it. Most people stand there and don't know what to do. Most people are in shock. They don't know what to do. It's not their fault. It's just nature. The people are just like, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. But I do know what to do, and I will do it. And I encourage other people to do it. My muscle memory is a little bit different than a lot of people's. I imagine just like first responders, they rush in. Next.
Dog sulks by the back door all the time. I can get to play and come, but then flies back.
Something about that back door makes your dog want to just hang out there. Next. I don't know. I there's a lot of variables there. I'd have to see it. Next.
Best way to get a dog to be neutral to his environment, not go crazy around people, flash places.
Yeah. What you do is you just have to learn how to control the dog's arousal. We talk about that a lot. We talk about arousal a lot. And don't get me wrong, high energy and arousal are two different things. So high energy and arousal. Arousal is just like a dog just like being excited all the time. I don't mind my dogs being excited. We went and played Chukka today. My dog came out of the SUV, all excited to play. Awesome. I don't mind. We get to the beach. I don't mind. But right now, like, they're not bored. They're not tired. They're just like hanging out with me. So, there's a time and a place to be, excited. Next.
I think our dog is reactive because of several off-leash dogs chasing us on our walks.
Yep, that'll do it.
Hate loose dogs.
Yep, that'll do it. Next.
For puppy biting, is bonking best or something with your finger and mouth? How to do finger and mouth?
You can do the thumb in the mouth. You stick it in the mouth to the back of the throat. You push down and you hold to the lower jaw. Try whichever one works. Next.
can my dog distinguish a dog that's on off or on leash? Will she treat it differently?
They actually can. By their movement, by the freedom of movement that they have. Next.
Tonight's theme is underwhelming the dog.
It's the theme of a lot of nights. I know.
What about night crating puppy with silent teething toys, or should I not give any toys at night?
Shout out to Seven Stars. Ken, my shadow student, oh, my buddy Ken, who's from Singapore. We have a shadow student from Singapore right now. He's spending the week with us. He was just at T3. He did a week at T3, a week of shadow, and then he's actually in our Airbnb, and he went with me to drop off Romy tonight, and then we went to the Indian restaurant right next to the ballet, and we went to the grocery store, and then we went over to Seven Stars. So big shout out to Ken if you're watching this. And I was inspired for a great business Skype after talking to Ken, and I'm gonna probably put that Skype out tomorrow. Was there a question?
Of course there was.
Sorry, the teething toy. Mm. So for me, I'm not against toys and crates. I just don't find it necessary. But I'm not against it. Next.
Do you ever use a stun baton on dogs in your center?
We have them there in different places. I think we've had to use them once. And if you don't know what a stun baton is, it's imagine a taser, but longer. It's not a training tool. It's not used for training a dog to do something. It's not used for punishing a dog. It's not like, oh, you didn't sit, stun. It's not used, oh, you jump, stun. It's not what it's used for. It's like a fire extinguisher. You only use it if there's a fire. Stun baton is only used if there's a dog fight. I believe it was used once. Next.
I have a 4-year-old Chihuahua mix that won't come when I call her. She's a runner. Suggestions?
Don't take her off leash. Never have that dog off leash until you fix it. You can get like really, you know, quarter inch nylon long line, 50 feet long if you have to. Keep the dog on a long line and then train the dog proper recall. So we've trained many small breed dogs under 10 pounds how to properly recall. Start out with food and a clicker. You can layer remote collar training over that. So next.
Thank you so much. Any plans for a seminar in Los Angeles or California?
Yes, I'll be in Los Angeles for T3 in February, and in the, I think this end of November, beginning of December, I will be in San Diego for an RV seminar. If you go to rvdogtrainer.com, I will be in San Diego. Next.
Can the dog become desensitized to a phone call?
Yes, they can. Which isn't a negative, by the way. It's like they can. And it's not because you used it wrong. I think a lot of dogs, that's why we love remote collars, because I think a lot of dogs are, if you don't stop an unwanted behavior on a dog, I mean, we put it this way, we have plenty of people that use, all breeds, by the way. All breeds are pretty much can train up the same way. You can have a dog walk politely on a prong collar for 12 years, so it did become desensitized to it. But if you underwhelm the dog constantly, it's not going to have much meaning to it. Does that make sense? Next.
I finally found the confidence to correct my GSD at a proper level, and now he's more engaged.
Good. If you own any power breed dog, congratulations, by the way, fist bump. If you own any power breed dog or sport dog, be prepared to give your dog a very good correction at least once in its life. So I'm glad that you were able to build up that confidence, because what you're doing is, it's almost like, a disservice. Next.
What are some good things to bring to a seminar?
Depends we put a list out, like a list went out tonight, for all the folks that are going to be in Chicago. If you're going as an auditor, just bring, a pen and a notebook and something comfortable, you can bring a nice comfortable chair. We supply chairs, but a lot of people bring those foldable camping chairs. Bring that, but all the snacks are there and the food is there and lunch is there. If you've got a dog, there's a list of things that you bring with your dog. Next.
2-year-old newly adopted boxer lab throws tantrums, grabbing my leg with paws and mouth when I tell her no.
So what you're doing is your dog is objecting to you. So your dog is saying no to your no. So what I would Who's that, Kira?
Girl.
Girl? Your eyes are open, too.
Mm-hmm. Weird.
Yeah. So, girl, knock it off. All right. So what I want you to do is, though, is, dreaming, yeah. What is the question? Okay, so yeah, your dog is grabbing at you. What you want to do is you can do a bonker. So bonker, no, boom, or remote collar. The fact that your dog is biting at your leg, grabbing at your leg, is your dog objecting to you. So you need to stop that. You need to stop it. Next.
Will a muzzle fix my dog's dominance over other dogs?
No, it will not, but it'll keep other dogs and your dog safe. So a muzzle is not a training tool. It's a safety protocol. It's a safety protocol. Training will teach your dog, will fix your dog's dominance over dogs. You will help educate your dog, but a muzzle will not. A muzzle will just prevent your dog from inflicting biting harm to a dog. Your dog could muzzle punch and harm a dog still. Your dog can also start a fight with a dog, but get its ass handed to him because it can't fight back. So therefore, you don't want to just count on the muzzle for the answer. But if your dog is getting into dog fights, absolutely muzzle. We recommend Baskerville muzzles. Baskerville muzzles can also be put in warm water. You can actually stretch them out a lot. Stretch them out a little bit to fit a little bit better. What's going to help you is you punishing dominant behavior over other dogs. Okay? And let's have a little bit of a break here for a minute here. You know, you've been hearing me talk a lot about, you know, punishment a lot. And punishment is not abuse. And just keep in mind, anytime, you know, our day is 90% reward and 10% punishment in our training center, and we work with some. Like today we have this husky out there that has put someone in the hospital, has gone after all my staff, attacked all my staff with intent to harm. And we did a Periscope today. It was probably about half an hour long, I think, and we spent actually 100% of the time rewarding that dog. 100% of the time rewarding the dog. Why? The dog didn't warrant any punishment. But when it goes after us, it gets punished. It's just interesting how it works. It's interesting. But the only way to stop an unwanted behavior is punishment. A lot of people ask me about that. I'm not defending myself. I'm doing full clarification. The reason is because so many people can't stop unwanted behaviors because they've been told to just ignore it or reward it. It's funny because we had an attendee at one of our week-long seminars for reactive dog. We were able to help her in a matter of minutes. A matter of minutes. She's been to, there's a class called, all these acronym classes, by the way, are full of shit. All this acronym stuff that you hear about is full of shit, you know, including BAT protocols. You know, just a little bit of a informational moment there. And I know there's a lot of people that will swear by BAT, but I'm not seeing it, and none of my clients have 18 months to see if it works or not. So there's a class called Click to Calm. And we use clickers to train dogs, by the way. We use food to train dogs. There's a class called Click to Calm. Nope. 18 classes she took. 5 minutes of teaching the dog the concept of don't be aroused when you're not supposed to. You decide. And the dog is doing great. 18 classes that didn't work. 5 minutes teaching the owner and the dog about arousal. Yep. So, Brittany, they told you to shove treats in your dog's face when she reacted. That's a very common thing. If I wanted my dog, first of all, this is the stupidest concept I've ever heard. A positive reinforcement trainer should understand the concept of learning theory in dogs. And they should understand that if you want a dog to do more of something, you reward it. I would like to think that every dog trainer understands the concept of reward-based training, no matter what your training modality is. If I want my dog to do more of something, I will reward the dog. It's not only is it common sense, but it's learning theory. If my dog is reacting and I'm taking food, which is a reward, as well as physical touch, verbal praise, toy, and then you have food. All right? And you're giving that dog food. What are you rewarding that dog for? Being reactive. It's common sense. It's common sense. Next.
What is the best exercise for a high-energy dog?
Teach your dog this. Not how to be lazy. Teach your dog how to be calm. Teach your dog how to be calm. Obviously, I'm a humongous advocate of exercise. I love to take my dog swimming. I love my dog to do chuck it. I love to do structured walks. I love to go bicycle riding with my dogs. I love to do obedience training, trick training, jumping over things. But duration work is the magic. Because if you don't spend time doing duration work, you're going to build yourself an athlete that always needs to move. Next.
I like to take my GSD biking every day to help with her energy.
Awesome. But on the flip side, teach calmness as well. Teach calmness as well. Next.
First time here, love your videos and information. In just 1 week, my four-month-old dog has gone from a good to a great dog. Thank you.
Well, congratulations. Tommy P, I don't believe in timeout. I don't believe in timeout. Don't believe in it. I believe it has no purpose for children and no purpose for dogs. So the way I use my punishment is in the moment for what they did, and then let's move on. But I use crates. Like my dogs are going to sleep in crates tonight. Whenever I go out of town, I mean, whenever I leave, they'll be in crates, right? So next.
I took a previous dog to a pet store training class to stop leash pulling. She told me to stop. I don't know.
Next.
I don't know where the rest is.
Don't even figure it out.
My dog chews everything. I mean everything. She's a border collie healer mix.
So number one, for the way you stop chewing is through punishment. But if you've got a border collie healer mix, a lot of people shouldn't own that breed because of the amount of work that they need. So unless you got one of them lazy ones, which not many people do. But no matter how much you exercise that dog, it's not going to stop the chewing. So it's two different things. I just want to get some information out there. In order to stop chewing, you can use a remote collar to stop chewing. Also, don't let your dog free roam for right now. So there's nothing for the dog to get access to chew. But on the side note also, with a border collie healer mix, let's get your dog in and make sure you get your dog into some sort of activity. So you can do trick training, agility, some sort of sport, nose work. Let's keep your dog busy, but not to keep it from chewing. Two separate things, but I just want to make sure if you own that breed, you're definitely meeting its needs for the breed, the genetics that it was designed for. Next.
I know this is bad, but how to get dog to eat all at once from free feeding?
It's not bad at all. If your dog doesn't eat all at once, it's just not hungry. Does that make sense? It's just not hungry. So your dog is good at monitoring its food intake. Some dogs are not. So I would cut down on your the amount of food. Next.
When my dog is in a downstay off leash and a dog runs up, will snap, not actually bite. Correct?
I would correct the other dog. I really would. I wouldn't correct my dog for that. Some people will say that's wrong. For me, I would just be like, I wouldn't allow an off-leash dog to run up to my dog in a downstay. Next. Now, if my dog was in a downstay at the training center, all right, if my dog was in a downstay at the training center, and there was a bunch of other dogs around it, and one of those dogs walked up to my dog and it snapped, yes, I would. So we have to put it into some context there. But if my dog was in a downstay, like in a park, and an off-leash dog ran up to it, and my dog snapped at it, I wouldn't punish my dog for that. Nope. Next.
I hear trainers say off-leash shouldn't be a novelty. Does a long line give them this feeling?
Dogs absolutely know when they're on a long line. Your average dog knows when it's on a leash and when not on a leash. I don't believe that off... I think off-leash is a privilege. I think it's a privilege. A dog has to earn the right to be off-leash by being obedient. But does the dog know that it's on a long line? I believe that it does. And the reason why The reason why is because when you clip the leash, when you unhook the leash from a dragging leash, the dog will behave differently. Next.
Have your dogs ever done tricks they know while not training, like on their own?
They spin around sometimes, but I think that's excitement. But that reminds me about another Facebook Live I'm gonna do. I'm gonna do another Facebook Live on something about opening up the refrigerator. Go ahead.
You want me to read a question? No. Is that what you're saying?
Yep.
Oh, they're coming in fast now. Dogs still having some issues around large dogs on walk after seminar, overall healing well, but gets distracted by other dogs still.
So you're probably got to go up on your remote collar. You're underwhelming your dog. Next.
I keep my border collie healer mix in a kennel so she won't chew everything. Is that okay?
If that's what works for you, then yes. But I would like, and I'm a big advocate of kennels and crates. What I'd like your dog to do, though, is to be in the kennel and crate when it's unattended, absolutely. But when you're home, you can have your dog around you and not have to crate it, and it can still behave properly. So let's up the obedience. For instance, my dogs can be around me, like, right now, and they're not going to be chewing things. So, because they're I know where they are. So just don't allow free roaming right now. Next.
Is Periscope available in Australia on desktop PC?
Our account, I believe it is. This Periscope, it should be available because you can get it on a PC, and then you can type questions and you can give hearts. You can watch our replays on YouTube. And you can watch replays on my Facebook page. As far as live, I think so, because I've got some fans in New Zealand. I've got some fans in Australia, so it's probably about the same. The same area. So we're seeing in about 60 countries this Periscope. Next.
What do you use for training when you feed raw? Usually you recommend kibble training.
They make lots of dehydrated raw. Oh, call of the wild. Yeah, you're New Zealand. I love New Zealand. Next.
I use baby gates to contain my dogs.
Yep, you can do that too.
Why is my dog so fixated on squirrels? Drives me crazy.
Because it's a dog. I love boobs. You know? Next.
I don't have anything else.
That's it? Oh, wow, cool. It's been an hour anyway. 9:45, yeah, it's been an hour. All right, Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, caninetraining.com, solidcaninetraining.com. Go check that out. And I think that's it for tonight, man. This was a good night. Tomorrow I'm going to do a couple of Facebook Lives, and I've got some really, really, really great stuff. Call of the Wild, did you get my personal message tonight? I definitely PM'd you back. I'm pretty sure I did. Let me know what you think. We can talk more. Good to know about a location in New Zealand. I never know, Tommy. Good. Tommy, I don't know. You know me. You know, I'm the non-schedule guy. The only
Mr. Spontaneous.
So I try to do my Q&As. In Australia. Yeah, I'm looking for a place in Australia. I'm looking for a place in Brisbane. I'm looking for a place in Brisbane because tools are allowed there. I've got a location in New Zealand, it sounds like it. And also, I've just located a place in Singapore, Malaysia, and Thailand. So it's possible I can do a combination of a Singapore, Malaysia, Thailand, Australia, New Zealand. So now I've got 5 seminar locations in that part of the world. So I can probably do some mixing and matching maybe. So so let me know. Yeah, Dog Sense Training. If you know of anybody in Brisbane, I was in Australia before. I've got a huge following in Australia. We can make it definitely work. And then I would probably do the Australia New Zealand seminar before I would do the Singapore, Malaysia, and Thailand seminar. So, all right, you gotta go. All right, I love all of you. I feel honored and blessed. Say goodbye to Linda.
Bye-bye.
Thank you all so much for listening. Thank you all so much for incorporating all the training that you're doing. You're all doing some fantastic stuff. I'm super proud of all of you. So many of you personal message me. So many of you will make comments. So many of you, I know you're fans. I want you to know that I appreciate every single one of you. My goal I'll be going on a big 4-month RV trip, and my goal, and there'll be constant, you know, training center updates, but I'm going to be doing a lot of voice, So we are on SoundCloud right now. We're on SoundCloud, we're on iTunes, we're on Google Play, and obviously those are going to be three really good platforms that you can be able to listen to me on, because I'm going to be stepping up my my voice, which means my voice content, which means non-video content. So I'll be really, I'll see you later, love you, I'll see you soon. Right. Which I'll be really, really stepping up my video content that you'll be seeing a lot of. I actually jumped onto Snapchat today. I have no idea what I'm going to be doing on Snapchat at all. I have no idea what I'm going to be doing on Snapchat. I'm trying to figure out what I'm going to be doing on that platform. But it skews a younger crowd. Hey, Raquel, love you, honey. It skews a younger crowd, but I'm going to start jumping on Snapchat personally. Yeah, Raquel, I have no idea what I'm doing with Snapchat yet. Instagram stories. So Instagram stories and Instagram I'm really good with. Instagram stories I think I'm doing a pretty good job with. Obviously, Facebook and YouTube, Twitter. Periscope, obviously you can tell that I'm still around. I was on 2 months after it was launched. I'm still here. Snapchat, though, I'm going to start dabbling in it. What I'm trying to figure out with Snapchat is what message do I want to get out? What do I want to get out? I try to come up with original content for every single platform that I am on. So I'm just not quite sure what I'm going to do with Snapchat. But I'm there. I put up, two snaps. I don't even know the terminology. I'm still trying to figure out how it all works. But I'm up. I'm on there. I'll be there daily. And one more platform. I love all of you. Take care. Honored and blessed that I can share. And I can't thank you all enough for just being there for me. All right.